Everybody, welcome back once again as we continue with module number 2, which is titled Special Semiconductor Devices for the subject Electronic Devices, abbreviated ED, subject code ECC302. So, welcoming the entire class of SE Electronics and Computer Science Semester 3. As per the syllabus, module number 2 contains unit number 2.1 as well as unit number 2.2. From the previous lecture number 11, we have already covered unit number 2.1, which contained the Zener diode as well as its application as a voltage regulator. For today's particular video lecture session, we will be beginning with unit number 2.2 by covering different other special semiconductor devices such as the varector diode, the Schottky diode, the photodiode, the light emitting diode, as well as solar cells. Today, our focus will be only on the topic varector diodes. So, as we continue with our journey by taking the topic of varector, also called as the varicap diode, the only prerequisite information which you need to have is a very good understanding about the PN junction diode as well as its applications, which was taken from unit number 1.1, taken in lecture number 2 for module number 1. The YouTube link as well as the QR code are given here. So, starting off, this is once again a simple revision about the PN junction diode operation. As we are all aware, the PN junction diode has technically three modes of operation. The first thing is operation under zero or no bias condition. The second one is operation under the forward bias condition. And the third one is operation under the reverse bias condition. Looking at the first case for operation under zero or no bias condition, this is how an unbiased PN junction looks like. You have the anode terminal, you have the cathode terminal, both are basically opened up. There is nothing connected over here. The P-type material contains holes as the majority carriers, and a few electrons in the form of minority carriers would be scattered here and there. Similarly, the N-type material contains electrons as the majority carriers, and a few holes, which are the minority carriers, would be scattered here and there. Once the P-type material and the N-type material are diffused or joined together at their interface boundary, we get a PN junction that is formed. Due to the huge difference of potential as well as the concentration gradients of electrons and holes that which are across the PN junction, you have a large influx of holes that go from P-type to the N-type material, and you have a large influx or the diffusion of electrons that go from the N-type into the P-type material. For every hole that leaves the P-type material and goes into the N-type material, it leaves behind an immobile negative ion. Similarly, for every electron that leaves the N-type material and diffuses into the P-type material, it leaves behind an immobile positive ion. After a certain point of time, this import-export process stops, since we have a huge wall of negative ions on one side and positive ions on one side, both of which actually repel or they do not allow the further diffusions of holes and electrons across the junction. This area is what we call as the depletion layer, or what we call it as the depletion region. So, looking at it, the presence of the negative and the positive charge ions on either side of the PN junction creates an internal electric potential or an internal electric field. This is called as the barrier potential, since it prevents the further diffusion of electrons and holes across the PN junction. This creates an internal electric field that actually restrains the further passage or the further diffusion of electrons and holes across the PN junction. It is typically 0.2 volts to 0.3 volts for germanium, while the value can be anywhere between 0.6 volts to 0.7 volts for silicon. The space near the junction, which is devoid of the free carriers, that is electrons or holes both, is called as the depletion layer. It is also called as the depletion region. Thus, the PN junction is in an equilibrium state with the formation of the depletion region or the depletion layer. Next, we look at the operation under the forward bias condition. So we have a battery or a supply voltage labeled as VS, which is completely external to the device. We have the positive terminal is given to the anode. Negative terminal is given to the cathode. Due to the like charges, holes are repelled away from the anode, electrons are repelled away from the cathode. And since the external battery voltage is sufficiently high or even more than the internal barrier potential, this particular battery will give enough energy for the holes to forcibly causing to cross them from the p-type material to the n-type material, and similarly for the electrons to cross over from the n-type into the p-type material. So what is observed is the depletion layer decreases. And as the depletion layer decreases, conductivity will improve because you have electrons and holes recombination taking place across the PN junction. We have holes that move towards the PN junction and they diffuse into the n-type material. Recombination will take place with the electrons. Similarly, electrons move towards the PN junction and they diffuse into the p-type material. Recombination takes place with the holes. So what we have is we have the positive terminal of the battery connected to the anode, which is a p-type semiconductor material. We have the negative battery terminal connected to the cathode, which is the n-type semiconductor material. The holes are repelled from the p-type material and they diffuse into the n-type material across the p-n junction. Similarly, electrons are also repelled from the n-type material and they diffuse into the p-type material across the p-n junction. The applied source voltage Vs should be sufficiently high enough so as to overcome the inbuilt potential barrier. The movement of electrons and holes across the p-n junction constitutes the electric current through the p-n junction diode. This is what we had seen long time back, much earlier, when we covered module number 1 titled p-n junction diode and its applications. Finally, for this particular forward bias mode of operation, we have a concept called as the diffusion capacitance. Since this particular topic was not a part of the actual syllabus, so this is being first introduced before we can go further. What you observe is the same diagram which you had seen for the forward bias mode of operation. Here, you can see an extremely thin wall which contains negatively charged ions near the p-n junction, but it is present on the p-type material side. Similarly, you have a thin wall of positively charged ions which is present near the p-n junction but on the side of the n-type material. Now, this gap is what we call as the depletion layer or the depletion region, because this entire area is completely devoid of any free or any charge carriers. Here, holes are of course the majority carriers and they are free to move anywhere. Electrons are here the majority carriers and they are again free to move anywhere. But since this particular region doesn't contain any kind of free electrons or free holes, it is called as a depletion layer or a depletion region because it is completely depleted of any free carriers. This particular structure can be now likened to a parallel plate capacitor, where the depletion layer or the depletion region will act as the dielectric material because there are no charge carriers present here. Whereas the p-type and the n-type semiconductor material, both being moderately to now heavily doped, will act as the two conducting plates. So this entire apparatus is acting like a parallel plate capacitor. The cross-section area for both of the materials remains the same. You also have a certain width or the thickness which is given by the distance d, and you have a certain permittivity which is a physical characteristic or a physical attribute of the depletion region or of the depletion layer. So this particular forward bias mode of operation introduces us to a concept called as the diffusion capacitance. The name comes diffusion because in the forward bias mode of the operation, you have holes diffusing from p-type into the n-type material, and you have electrons diffusing from the n-type material into the p-type material. Let us see how this particular diffusion capacitance takes place. What we have is holes are diffused from the p-type material into the n-type material across the junction. You have electrons are diffused from the n-type material into the p-type material across the junction. The forward bias facilitates the diffusion of these charge carriers or charge transfer across the p-n junction, which is based on the above point number 1 and 2. The density of the charge carriers will be very high near the p-n junction, but it will decrease with the distance away from the p-n junction. So what we get is, as the forward bias voltage keeps on increasing, there is also an increase in the diffused charge across the p-n junction. Here delta Vs represents a very small or a typical infinitesimal increment in the voltage, while delta QD represents a very small increment or a typical infinitesimal change or an increment in the diffuse charge. Thus, the charge is stored on both sides of the p-n junction in the forward bias. Hence, we get the diffusion or we get the storage capacitance, because there is a bit of charge which is stored in the form of ions along the entire p-n junction boundary or the p-n junction interface. You have a thin wall of positive ions near the p-n junction but on the side of the n-type material, and you have a wall of negative ions near the p-n junction but on the side of the p-type material. The diffusion capacitance given by CD mathematically can be expressed by the equation CD is equal to tau into ID divided by eta into VT, where tau is nothing but the mean lifetime of the carriers given in seconds. ID is simply the forward bias current through the p-n junction diode. Keep in mind, current is nothing but the transport of electric charge. Eta is simply the empirical constant. Typically, its value is between 1 and 2. VT is the thermal voltage, also called as the volt equivalent of temperature. Under normal room temperature, assuming T is equal to 300 degrees Kelvin or 27 degrees centigrade, we have VT is equal to 26 millivolts. That is what we have for CD. The same can be graphically plotted with the variation of diffusion capacitance, usually expressed in terms of picofarads, along with the voltage across the diode given as shown. So the graph usually looks like this. We are also aware of the fact that once the p-n junction diode is in the forward bias mode of operation, the voltage across the diode does not exceed typically beyond 0.6 or say 0.7 volts, although the current through it will increase rapidly. That is what we have seen for the VI characteristics. So once again, what we see is that the diffusion capacitance will increase exponentially as the voltage across the diode increases. But the span is usually very short because the voltage cannot go beyond 0.6 or 0.7 volts. But however, as the supply voltage will increase further, the current through the diode also increases. And as per the particular expression mentioned, the diffusion capacitance CD is directly proportional to the current that is flowing through the p-n junction diode. When we see the operation under the reverse bias mode of operation, we have the exactly reverse part as compared to the forward bias mode. Here the battery polarity is simply reversed. You have the battery negative terminal connected to the anode, but you have the battery positive terminal given to the cathode, due to which there is attraction. The holes are attracted towards the negative charge. The electrons are now attracted towards the positive charge. So what happens is the depletion layer widens. And as the depletion layer widens, the number of ions depositing at either side of the p-n junction will increase gradually. So what we see is we have holes are moving away from the p-n junction and they are going towards the battery negative terminal. The electrons here are moving away from the p-n junction and they are going towards the battery positive terminal. So here we see that the depletion layer is actually widening. Now, once again, if you compare this with a typical capacitor, the standard formula for a capacitor, C is equal to epsilon A by D. That is purely in physical terms of the capacitance attributes. So since D is in the denominator, the D here can be now likened to the depletion layer width as shown. So as the depletion layer width increases, the capacitance should decrease. So what we get is under the reverse bias mode of the operation, we have the battery negative terminal connected to the anode, which is nothing but the p-type material. We have the positive battery terminal connected to the cathode, which is nothing but the n-type material. The holes are attracted towards the battery negative terminal and they go away from the p-n junction. The electrons are attracted towards the battery positive terminal and they move away from the p-n junction. The width of the depletion region or the depletion layer increases as holes and electrons move gradually away from the p-n junction. No current flows through the p-n junction diode since you do not have any recombination of electrons and holes that take place. Of course, there will be a very small reverse saturation leakage current present due to the minority carriers. But since their amount is very small, it basically can be ignored here. This phenomena of reverse bias gives us rise to something called as transition capacitance. That's the same diagram shown. And the same diagram is also shown in a slightly simple form as this one. So what you see is that as the reverse bias voltage or the applied voltage Vs increases further, even by a small fraction of delta Vs, you have the depletion layer width also increasing gradually with a small amount delta W. On one side, we have the holes moving away from the p-n junction towards the battery negative terminal. So you have an increment in the negative charge with the increase or the increment in the reverse bias voltage. Similarly, as electrons move away from the p-n junction, we also have an increment in the accumulation of positive charge with the increase or the increment in the reverse bias voltage that is given by delta Vs. Since we are actually having transition of the depletion layer width, so the charge that is accumulated here is what is called as the transition capacitance. So what we see is the width of the depletion region or the width of the depletion layer increases as holes and electrons move away from the p-n junction. The applied reverse source voltage Vs will now exert a much larger electric field E across the particular reverse bias p-n junction. This large electric field across a space charge region will increase the number of negative and positive charges. As the width of the depletion region or the depletion layer increases, additional charges are also created in the entire process. In the reverse bias mode of the operation, as the supply voltage Vs increases further, you also have an increment of the charge with the applied voltage. And this is due to a junction capacitance, which is called as a transition capacitance due to the transition of the depletion layer width, as W will increment by delta W for every increment in the applied reverse bias voltage. Thus, what we see is the junction capacitance is of two types. In the forward bias mode, we have diffusion capacitance, but in the reverse bias mode, we are having transition capacitance. Looking at the graph which shows the variation in transition capacitance with the applied reverse bias voltage, the graph is pretty much longer because the reverse bias voltage which is applied can go on to a very large extent. So what we see is transition capacitance has a very wide range of variation in the reverse bias mode of operation as compared to the diffusion capacitance for the forward bias. Although you may now also claim that the diffusion capacitance was very high, the only problem is to control the amount of diffusion capacitance, because the window to control the voltage is extremely small, typically from 0 volts to 0.6 or 0.7 volts. But here the window to control the voltage is quite large. So you have a huge variation in the capacitance in the reverse bias mode of the operation. Usually, PN junction diodes can have two main types of junctions. One is the abrupt or the step graded PN junction, which is as shown. This graph can be basically compared to a PN junction, and this axis shows the distance from the PN junction. The left-hand side is of the P-type material. Right-hand side is of the N-type material. Since we are having a P-type material, we have a certain amount of acceptor atoms added. So Na shows the number of acceptor atoms over here. Since electrons are the minority carriers, the axis below it negatively shows us the concentration of electrons as the minority carriers. For the N-type material, you basically add donor atoms. So this shows the concentration or the level of the donor atoms, while this one shows the concentration of the holes as the minority carriers. For an abrupt or a step graded PN junction, the transition capacitance can be calculated by using the laws of semiconductor physics as Ct is equal to A, brackets open, square root of Q into epsilon upon 2, the whole term multiplied by Nd divided by VBI, brackets closed, where Q is nothing but the electron charge given by 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19 coulombs. Epsilon is simply the permittivity of the semiconductor material given in terms of farads per meter. A is the cross-section area of the semiconductor given in meter square. Nd is nothing but the concentration of the donor impurity atoms given by the number per meter cube. So that is depending upon the volume. And VBI is nothing but the intrinsic barrier potential. For a hyper abrupt or a linearly graded PN junction, what we see is that the doping level is not uniform or is not the same throughout. It slopes down. It is maximum towards the junction, but its concentration will decrease as one moves away from the PN junction, which is both for the acceptor level as well as for the donor level. For such hyper or linearly graded PN junctions, we have the equation as follows. The transition capacitance Ct is given by the formula Ct is equal to A, brackets open, the whole square root Q into epsilon upon 6, the whole term multiplied by Nd upon VBI, where all the terms have the same meaning. The only difference which we are able to see from the earlier case was the constant 2 in the denominator has now been replaced by the number 6. So this particular property of the variation of transition capacitance with the applied reverse bias is exploited by a device called as the varector or the varicap diode. Varector stands for the word variable reactor, while varicap stands for the term variable capacitance. So these are PN junction diodes designed with a slightly different doping level, with a slightly different construction, such that their capacitance across the PN junction changes as a function of the applied reverse bias voltage across it. This particular diagram shows a commercial structure or the commercial construction of a widely available varicap or a typical varector diode. What you see is a typical mesa based structure over which an N-type region has been diffused, over which a P-type region is grown, and we have molybdenum metal terminals both for the anode as well as for the cathode side. The whole unit is enclosed in a ceramic tube to give it strength and to also give it proper insulation. Gold is normally used to improve the conductivity and to also improve the ohmic contacts for the anode and for the cathode terminals. So quickly, looking at the part of the structure or the part of the construction, it is formed by merging a P-type semiconductor with an N-type semiconductor material, just similar to a PN junction diode. As per the applications, both the P-type and N-type materials are either made of silicon or they are either made of gallium arsenide, called as GaAs. The N-type material is connected with a molybdenum metal of gold plating through the mesa structure, which serves as the cathode. The P-type material is connected with a molybdenum metal via the gold wire, which forms the anode terminal. Gold is used commonly because the conductivity improves. Apart from gold, the other options are silver as well as platinum. However, by using gold and silver as well as platinum, the cost also goes up. To keep the cost low, aluminium is the most widely used material. We have the ceramic layer used to enclose the whole structure of the diode, apart from the anode and the cathode terminals. Both the N-type and the P-type semiconductor materials have different doping profiles as compared to ordinary PN junction diodes, and the only reason why the doping profiles are different is because the transition capacitance has to be basically enhanced such that it should be a function of the applied reverse bias voltage across the diode. In the market, commercially available varicap or varieted diodes are as shown here. The symbol is quite interesting. It is exactly similar to an ordinary PN junction diode. But however, this particular part shows similar to a variable capacitor or a typical trimmer. So you have a PN junction diode and you also have a capacitor both combined into one. And this particular variable terminal shows that the capacitance can be varied with the change in the voltage across the anode and the cathode terminals. If we look at the working is completely based on the changes in the transition capacitance across the PN junction with the change in the applied reverse bias voltage across the PN junction diode. This is the diagram which, from the examination point of view, you are expected to sketch when you are asked to explain the working or when you are asked to explain the operation of a varactor or a typical varicap diode. So just quickly reviewing the entire operation, under the reverse bias conditions, depletion layer or the depletion region will act as a typical dielectric due to the absence of the charge carriers, that is electrons as well as holes. The P-type material as well as the N-type material act as a typical capacitor having parallel plates on account of moderate to high doping levels. The increase in the reverse bias voltage will increase the width of the depletion region or the depletion layer, also called as the space charge region. As the width of the depletion region or the depletion layer increases, this is exactly now analogous to increasing the thickness of the so-called dielectric material, that is the space charge region at the PN junction. Hence, the capacitance overall reduces because it is inversely proportional to the width or the thickness of the depletion region or of the depletion layer. The capacitance thus becomes dependent only upon the applied reverse bias voltage due to the transition in the width of the depletion region. The width of the depletion region or the depletion layer will increase as holes and electrons are moving away from the PN junction. The applied reverse bias source voltage VS will exert an extremely large electric field E across the reverse bias PN junction. This large electric field across the space charge region increases the number of negative as well as positive charges. As the width of the depletion region or the depletion layer increases, additional charges are also created in the entire process. Thus, for a reverse bias mode of operation, increment in the applied reverse bias source voltage will also increase the charge. So you have a charge increment with the voltage increment as well. This leads to the formation of a junction capacitance, which is also called as the transition capacitance due to the transition of the width W of the depletion region or of the depletion layer. The same capacitance voltage characteristics are as shown. We prefer to having the transition capacitance compared to the diffusion capacitance because the window in which the voltage can be changed is quite large as compared to the forward bias mode. We have three main equations given by CTO: CT as a function of voltage and CT as a function of both the original capacitance as well as the voltage applied across it. So if you see the VI characteristics, they are actually the plot of transition capacitance CT against the applied reverse bias voltage across the diode given by the term VD. This shows an exponentially decreasing curve of the variation in the transition capacitance as the diode reverse voltage increases. This is due to the fact that transition capacitance CT is inversely proportional to the depletion region with W. The variation in the depletion region with W directly depends upon the changes in the reverse bias voltage, that is VD, across the PN junction diode. This particular transition capacitance CT is very high as compared to ordinary PN junction diodes because it is due to the way in which the structure, construction, and also the different doping profiles have been achieved. The maximum value of the transition capacitance is under the zero or the no bias condition, after which it will simply continue to decrease exponentially. The original equation for the transition capacitance under a zero or a no bias condition is given by the symbol CT0 or CTO. That is given by epsilon into A upon the value W, which is again exactly similar to that of a parallel plate capacitor. Here CTO or CT0 is nothing but transition capacitance at zero or no bias conditions. Epsilon is simply the permittivity. Epsilon zero, the permittivity of free space. Epsilon R, relative permittivity of the device used. A is the cross-section area, and width is nothing but the width of the unbiased depletion layer, the original width. Now this width can change. It can increase for reverse bias, but it can decrease for the forward bias. In terms of the applied voltage, CT is given by K divided by VT plus VD, the whole terms raised to N, where K is a constant, and this constant depends upon the semiconductor physics parameters, which is again dependent upon the material used, the fabrication technique, construction, etc. VT is the thermal voltage, and VD is the applied reverse bias voltage across the PN junction diode. N is again a constant term given by half, 0.5 or 1 by 2 for alloyed junctions, and its value is roughly 0.667 or 2 by 3 for diffused junctions. And finally, the transition capacitance expressed in terms of the original capacitance is given by CT is equal to CT0 divided by brackets open 1 plus VD upon VT, the whole term raised to N, where CT0 is the original transition capacitance at zero or no bias conditions. VT is of course the thermal voltage. VD is the voltage applied across the diode. And N is again the constant, which is half for alloyed junctions and 2 by 3 for diffused junctions. It is very easy to see that without any voltage applied, VD becomes zero. So the equation for CT reverts back to CT0 or CTO, which is again nothing but dependent upon the diode physical parameters given by the permittivity, the cross-section area, and the original unmodulated or unchanged width during the unbiased condition. Different applications for the varector or the varicap diode are in voltage control oscillators, in phase lock loops, that is PLL, for frequency modulated FM demodulators, for frequency synthesizers, for radio frequency, that is RF filters, for frequency and phase modulators, that is for FM and PM, for television receivers working in the very high frequency, that is VHF, and the ultra high frequency, that is UHF bands. Also frequency multipliers. And finally, parametric amplifiers. With this, we end the session of varector or the varicap diodes. The list of textbooks once again remains the same as we had taken for module number 1 as well as module number 5. This book is actually highlighted in red because although not a part of your actual syllabus, but this book still contains a lot of important material which you can refer for all the previous modules, module number 1, module number 5, and currently module number 2. The list of the entire reference books also is the same. We have Robert Bolstead, David Bell, Mohammad Rashid, along with Salivan and Suresh Kumar. And finally, the list of websites are also the same as we had seen in the previous video lecture when we covered unit number 2.1. We have Byju's, Engineering Tutorials, electronictutorials.ws, allaboutcircuits.com, electronics-notes.com, electronicsdesk.com, electronicshub.org, and finally electriciantraining.tpub.com. That will be all for today. Here we end with the topic of varector or varicap diodes. Thank you very much.